We can't hear me. Is this working? Is this working? Speak into this. Close it. Speak close to the microphone. I feel like beginning with the announcement that it's Justin's birthday. You want us to sing happy birthday? That's what I meant to the announcement.
Sharon Shapiro, trustee of the Ruderman Family Foundation and head of the Boston office, I always say is the heart and soul of the Ruderman Synagogue Inclusion Project. It is such a privilege to work with Sharon. She is so dedicated and caring. And CJP is so proud to partner with the foundation who works so tirelessly to make this world a more just and righteous place. In this time when our differences tend to divide us rather than unite us, many have noted that the signature of the Ruderman Synagogue Inclusion Project is felt in the power of rabbis and synagogues of all denominations who work together and agree on some significant shared values around inclusion of all people in Jewish life. To be inclusive is to be holy, and including each, strengthening all, is the mission of the Ruderman Family Foundation and what guides us in our own work every day. Sharon and her family and colleagues, including Jasmine Gotthell, who is my guiding program officer for this project as it began, believe that each of us viewing all people as bringing unique contributions to the world is what really turns a synagogue from a collection of people to a Kehillah Kedoshah, holy community. And it's just such an honor to work with them. This project started with 3 synagogues and has grown to over 30 synagogues in this area. We're about to add 9 new Arsha partners to this year's cohort and 6 affiliates. And you're going to be hearing today from Karen Tabb and Sandy Aronson from Temple Beth Elohim. Their synagogue was one of our original cohort members. And the work that we do, we see so many of our synagogues making wonderful progress in areas of inclusion. Synagogues are now installing wheelchair-friendly ramps to the bima, providing large print braille sitterines for visually impaired, bringing in ASL coordinators and interpreters for the deaf, and offering inclusive programming for kids with physical and developmental disabilities. Unfortunately, we are not seeing the same progress in the area of mental health. With an estimated 1 in 4 people directly affected by mental illness, chances are that every person here today in this room has either suffered from a mental health issue or has been close to someone who has or knows of people in your synagogues or your community who have. The stigma associated with mental illness can easily deter people from getting help or even talking about their experience. Addressing mental health concerns is a common challenge for the congregations that we work with. We hear from rabbis and inclusion committees across Greater Boston that they are struggling with this issue. And one of our goals at the Ruderman Synagogue Inclusion Project is to share best practice. And we hope that others will look to the growing number of synagogues in Boston who have begun mental health initiatives and models. The goal is to ease the loneliness and isolation that mental illness can cause. This is a preventable side effect. When we interviewed Rabbi Rachel Sapphire from Temple Beth Elohim for a recent CJP article for CJP News, she said, "I've been approached by a congregant who said, when someone is in the hospital, we send them a biscuit, we visit them, we check in on them after they get home. But when someone is at McLean, which specializes in psychiatric care, we do nothing. I realized that he was right, and it was gut-wrenching," said Rabbi Sapphire. It was with this realization that TBE started their mental health initiative. People from throughout the congregation, from all walks of life and a variety of professions came together to create an environment where members could openly share their struggles and their strength, caring for a community in body, mind, and spirit. "We were stunned," said the chair of their mental health committee, who you'll hear from today. "So many people showed up and their stories just poured out. It verified that they had felt tremendously isolated. As Jews, we know a great deal about being there for each other during times of unbearable suffering. It doesn't matter what we call it or how it is diagnosed, Jews have never stepped away from providing comfort to those who are suffering. We don't want to replicate the services that other community agencies provide. We use Jewish teaching and values to explore how we can fill unmet needs and support our congregants." Sharon Shapiro has been an active member of the Greater Boston philanthropic community for many years. Her current projects reflect her family's deep commitment to promoting disability inclusion in the Jewish community. She's also passionate about teaching teens in philanthropy, serving on the Teen Foundation of Greater Boston. Sharon has made major contributions to inclusive Jewish education through many years of service on the board of directors of Gateways, Access to Jewish Education. She also serves on the board of directors of Combined Jewish Philanthropy, as well as the Committee for Services for People with Disabilities and the Special Education Committee, all at CJP. She is also the incoming chair of CJP's Miriam Fund. The fund aims to inspire and strengthen women and girls through grants within and beyond the Jewish community. Sharon also serves on the Disability Task Force of Greater Boston. Active in a variety of Jewish organizations, Sharon's affiliations include President Circle of Amit and Yad Chesed. Sharon is passionate about the fact that reducing the mental health stigma in our synagogues is a natural step for our synagogue inclusion work, and it's my privilege to introduce her today. Thank you, Molly. It's a pleasure to be here. Good morning. I'm delighted to be here with you today to welcome you on behalf of the Ruderman Family Foundation. As you may know, my family and our foundation believes that inclusion and understanding of all people is essential to a fair and flourishing community. We promote the inclusion of people with disabilities in all sectors of society, including Jewish and secular schools, camps, places of work, synagogues, and more. We know that when we welcome people with disabilities into our communities, all of us benefit as our communities become stronger and more vibrant. We view inclusion not as a charity, but as civil rights, social justice, and critical to Jewish continuity. The Ruderman Family Foundation is proud to partner with CJP on the Ruderman Synagogue Inclusion Project. Through this initiative, dozens of synagogues throughout the greater Boston area have embraced inclusion. Synagogue leaders have made their communities more accessible and welcoming, and they have learned through experience that small steps can make a big difference. It has been wonderful to watch communities transform into places that are even more vibrant than when they were when they began. Thank you to Molly Silver, who has been such an incredible leader in this work. This year, the Ruderman Synagogue Inclusion Project has focused on mental health. We are so delighted to be part of this work because we recognize that synagogues can play a central role in supporting people and families with mental illness. To many people, the synagogue community embodies home. We must make sure that all people, including those with mental illness, feel recognized, valued, and embraced by their synagogue communities. We must work together to make sure that the synagogue is a place where people find support and not silence or judgment. I'm so happy to be here with you today so that we can learn together about mental health and how we as a community can live up to our greatest potential. Thank you.
Rabbi Mark is the senior rabbi and co-director of Beit Teshuvah, and an incredibly compassionate, thoughtful, and learned individual. Beit Teshuvah is a nonprofit Jewish addiction treatment center and synagogue community in Los Angeles. Over the past 28 years, he has co-created one of the most exceptional approaches to addiction treatment and reintegration in the world. Rabbi Mark's tireless efforts have been the driving force behind not only the robust and growing movement that is Beit Teshuvah, but also redefining the recovery model and helping all people, both in recovery and not, find their path to wholeness. Rabbi Joshua Heschel teaches that just to be is a blessing, just to live is holy. This is what Rabbi Mark does each and every day through his work. We are also fortunate to have copies of his book here, and I encourage you to read it and continue learning and share his teachings with your community. It is my pleasure to introduce.
I'm going to record this because I never say the same thing twice, and the people of Beit Teshuvah want me to record things for posterity because I'm getting old. So my name is Mark, and I'm an alcoholic and a criminal in recovery with a pure soul. I learned this from Rabbi Dr. Abraham Twersky to acknowledge myself in this way, to qualify. Let me give you a little background on me and on Beit Teshuvah, and then I'm going to go into what we do. Actually, I may put it all together. I confuse things a lot of times. So I'm a nice Jewish boy from Cleveland, Ohio. There was one criminal in my family, but you know. No drugs, no nothing. And growing up, I felt half a step off. So I was listening to Sharon, and I thought, wow, you really have it all together. I mean, like, you're really Got it. You know it. You get it. You have no problems. Nothing. Of course, it's not true, but that's the way I thought. See, I thought everybody else had it together. People were smarter than me. Cuter. Definitely thinner, because I was always a fat boy. So I kept judging my insides by everybody else's outsides. And I had a trauma when I was 14 years old. That was that my father passed away, died of a 7th heart attack in 7 years. So really the trauma started with the first heart attack. And my father was my best friend. He knew my soul. He knew me. I could count on him to accept me no matter what and to love me. My mother's a wonderful woman. She's 92 years old. She's still as feisty as ever. And my father and I had this special bond. So I got lost. And this was back in 1966. Probably most of you don't know this, but my mother was making $2 an hour. And she had to support 3 children and herself. And the house payment was $150 a month. So if you do the math, it just doesn't add up. So being the enterprising young man I was, I knew that I had to do something. So I went to our local barber, who was also a fence for the mafia, and I said, I need to help mom out, and I started selling hot merchandise on the inside. And I made a good living, actually. There were times when I was making $100, $200, $300 a week. Back in 1967, 68, there was a lot of money. I didn't keep it that bit. I wasn't that smart. But I got into a whole way of living. Because you see, when I grew up, if you had money, you were something, and if you didn't have money, you were nothing. Unlike today, where money doesn't really make a difference to people, they just experience everyone as holy and good, right? So I thought I didn't matter. The people we treat a big shoot, the people we care for, our communities, a community of people who were either told, who were told implicitly or explicitly that they didn't matter. People who got the message that they weren't good enough, weren't smart enough, weren't this enough, weren't that enough. People who just said, you know what, I don't want to fight. People whose Jewish education was either nil or was all about the bar bat mitzvah. People who never understood, were never taught the beauty and the joy of Yiddishkeit. I was blessed when my father passed away because I went to the minyan. My father wasn't a particularly religious man. We belonged to a conservative shul. And I want to speak right now about the role of clergy. When my father died, my oldest brother was at Fort Knox doing 6 months because he was in the National Guard. We had no idea what to do, how to get in touch with him. We called the chazan and the rabbi from the shul. I made 3 calls. The doctor, my father's doctor, came over and signed a death certificate, and that our chazan and our rabbi. And both of them showed up. All 3 of them showed up. And our chazan, Cantor Shalom Heisel, is a blessed memory. Made 2 calls, and my brother was on a bus from Fort Knox, Kentucky, coming up to Cleveland, Ohio. For that alone, I loved him anyway, and for that alone, he had my undying love and admiration and loyalty. So I went to shul and I davened with the old men. Now the old men at that time were all from Europe. And they were verbrenta daveners. They didn't pray. I mean, I don't understand praying, to tell you the truth. I understand davening. And I learned how to daven, and I tell the story because it encapsulates what davening was for them and what it became for me. The old man Jacobs walked on two canes, had two hearing aids. Forced me to the sitter by heart. Used the prayer book, told me to sit next to him. Used the prayer book, and every time he turned the page, he kissed his fingers first as a way of saying how much he loved prayer and loved God. I never forgot that all these years. We're talking 52 years ago. So, at Beit Shuva, what we do is we help people understand that they matter. Now, one of my favorite teachers is Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel. I am nuts about Rabbi Heschel. Because for me, he spoke to me. He said, the Bible is an answer to the question, what does God require of humans? But to modern humans, this question is suppressed by another one. Namely, what do we demand of God? We continue to ponder, what will I get out of life? What escapes our attention is the fundamental yet forgotten question, what will life get out of me? I want to tell you, for 20 years after my father died, 23 years after my father died, what life got out of me was chaos. It got terror and chaos. I was an alcoholic and a thief and a con and a liar. My father, who I loved dearly, all he cared about was being mentioned. And I stepped on his grave, I stepped on his memory. And every time I realized that I drank more, I moved to California. The only problem was they took me with me. So, in California, though, it wasn't the same as Ohio. They didn't have as much of a sense of humor about crime and stuff like that. They actually put you in jail or prison. You couldn't buy off a judge. It was just un-American to me. And what happened was, I started to go to jail and prison. I got married. I have a daughter who's 37 years old. She's everything to me. And as much as I love my daughter Heather, it didn't make me get sober and it didn't stop me from my crime. For the first 8 years of our lives, six of them, I was in and out of county jail and state prison. I took this beautiful soul, and all this time thinking, I don't matter, nobody cares, and all this other stuff. And I took this wondrous soul, and I crushed her spirit because she couldn't trust her father to be there or to show up, even for her first day of school. I say this to you because A, it's true, and B, the impact that we have on other people, we just don't realize most of the time. In prison, when I got arrested the last time in 1986, I had a spiritual awakening. I said, the man upstairs is trying to tell me something, and I have to sit here until I can figure it out. Well, it's 31 plus years later, and I still haven't figured out exactly. And I'm a lot closer. See, I called my brother, who's been a rabbi forever, since 75. And I said, send me a Silverman prayer book and a Hertz Kodesh, because I was a conservative Jew. My brother is a Reform rabbi, so he sent me a plowed Torah and gates of prayer. And I thanked him. And I started the Dhamma and I started to read. I studied. But first I've been introduced to Rabbi Heschel by Rabbi Mel Silverman, the prison chaplain, prison rabbi in Chino. And Rabbi Heschel, in his interview with Carl Stern, said we have to immerse ourselves in the Bible. Immersing myself in the text changed my entire life, because it wasn't just for lessons. It wasn't something that I would argue with. It was me seeing me in that text. When God calls Ayeka, and Adam hides, I cried. I thought about all those times when God was calling, Ayeka, Ayeka, where are you? Where are you, Mark? And I was hiding. So I'm going to ask all of you today to take a look at yourselves and ask yourselves the question, what are you hiding from and when do you hide? How are you missing the call of God and the call of others? How are you missing the call of the text? Rabbi Heschel says, this indeed is the purpose of our religious traditions, to keep alive the higher yes, as well as the power of humans to say, you made me, here I am. To teach our minds to understand the true demand, and to teach our conscience to be present. Too often we misunderstand the demand, too often the call goes forth, and history reports our conscience is absent. I am so thrilled that you all are doing this. I think this is amazing. I wish more rabbinical schools would do this. And I have to ask you, where have you been? Because if we only look at what we're doing, we can pat ourselves on the back very well. We have to look, where have we been? So you have a foundation who has been doing this for years, talking about it, and I'm sure meeting much, pushback. Because Jews don't have these problems. So I've been a Beit Shuva for 29 and a half years. The founder of it is Harriet Rosetto, who's a licensed clinical social worker. It's an outgrowth of a program called the Jewish Committee for Personal Service that visited Jewish men and women in jail and prison and mental hospitals since 1921. And we were always told, shh. Don't talk about this. So, of course, when I came, I started talking to everybody. But the Federation itself didn't want us to talk about it. We live in a time where everything we do matters. We live in a time where people are marginalized, where people can't walk into a Jewish place and feel at home, feel like they belong, because they have mental illness and or addictions. Families live in shame. They're afraid to go to their rabbis. Can you imagine at this moment of utter pain and bewilderment? The rabbi in the synagogue is the last place the Jews will go for fear of being shamed. What are we doing? I'm sorry if I get too crazy It's just in me. I'm actually a black preacher more than I am a rabbi. Think about this. Do you realize how much you matter and how much every individual matters? Our traditions, my friend and teacher, Rabbi Edward Feinstein, teaches that each one of us are a word of Torah. And as we know, if one word is missing from the Torah, it's pasul. But what about all of us that we have allowed to go missing? How can the world ever be whole? How can we have a valid world if we're not helping everybody be who they are? Bring their word of Torah. Bring what they, only they can bring to this world. Our Talmud says, we all come from one Adam for three reasons. I'm sure you all know this. One is because whoever destroys a single soul is as if they've destroyed an entire world. Whoever saves a single soul is as if they've saved an entire world. I learned from Rabbi Yitzchak Greenberg that means that all of us have infinite value and dignity. Think about it. You have infinite value and dignity. You're worth an entire world. You're precious. Do you treat yourself as if you're precious? I didn't for a long time. I still don't do it perfect. The second reason is because nobody can say my father is better than yours. So he taught that means we have equal infinite worth and dignity. Do you realize that the person sitting next to you, in front of you, behind you, is a precious gem? And do you treat them like that? Or are you treating them as somebody that you have to beat? You have to be better than, because you're in comparison and competition. Third reason, when humans mint coin, unlike humans, when they mint coins from the same mold, every coin comes out the same. Kodosh Baruch Hu mints humans from the same mold, and each one of us is different. So we should carry around a piece of paper that says the world was created for my sake. Do you realize your uniqueness? How much are you still trying to be the same as everybody else, which is Chilul Hashem according to our tradition? A desecration of God's name. So at Beit Shuva, we teach everyone matters. We live, everyone matters. We're a long-term residential, Jewish, faith-based, non-sectarian recovery center. We have Jews and non-Jews. Everybody goes to Torah study every morning. And all of the rabbis who teach, who lead Torah studies in the morning, we have a bunch of rabbis working there and interns, rabbinical students. If they don't see themselves in the text, I fire them.